Thank you, Pastor Kitty. Wow. What on earth is happening? I mean, I got the shots, then got COVID. What on earth's going on? I never thought that I'd have cancer. I mean, in 1,000 years, I never intended something like this to happen. Have you had experiences like that in your life where things just didn't turn out the way you thought they were going to turn out? Well, open your Bibles then this morning to Revelation chapter 5. You may have it on your device or your phone, or you may have memorized it. But let's look in Revelation chapter 5. I want to answer, I believe, one of the most important questions in life. Who is in control? It's very important. Hey, you would feel like I feel right now, scared to death, honored, humbled. I'm not scared of you, or I'm scared that I might not be able to say everything that he wants me to say. I've prayed about this because I know I'll have to give an account of this one day, like every time any of us have to speak, get to speak. And so I've prayed thoroughly through this, and I'm just going to deliver to you what I've received from the Lord. This is from the Word of God. I mean, just give a quick explanation to set this scripture up in Revelation chapter 5. It surrounds something called a scroll. 2,000 years ago, important documents were written out, not in books like we have today that's bound like this, but in a scroll. And then when it was finished, they would tightly bound the scroll, melt wax, put it on the edges so that it would not unravel. Don't miss that word. And therefore, it was kept. That's the scroll. This chapter is about a scroll. For all practical purposes, we would say it in our language, a book. This is a book. The most important book next to the Lamb's Book of Life is this book. This book contains all the events of all human history, of all people. Your birth, your death, your marriage, your children, your parents, where, when, schooling, all of that. Those things we considered accidents, coincidence, tough luck, all of that kind of stuff. None of that's true. It's all written in the book, this scroll. And whoever is able to take this scroll and to open those seals is the one who's able to control human destiny, who's able to control what happens to all humans' lives. That's what this is about, Revelation chapter 5. And God gives John this revelation. Remember Revelation? This is the only book in the Bible that I know of that has the outline in the very beginning of the book in Revelation 1:19. He says, write these things which are, those things which you have seen, and those things which will come to pass after this. Revelation chapter 5 is a part of those things that will come to pass after this. Now, if you're comfortable, you're settled down, then I hate to ask you to do this, but why don't you stand to your feet? This is in honor of the Word of God. Revelation chapter 5, you ready? I saw in the right hand of him who sat on the throne a scroll written inside and on the back, sealed with 7 seals. Then I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, who is worthy to open the scroll and to loose its seals? And no one in heaven or on the earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or to look at it. So I wept much because no one was found worthy to open and to read the scroll or to look on it. But one of the elders said to me, do not weep. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has prevailed to open the scroll and to loose its 7 seals. And I looked, and behold, in the midst of the throne and of the 4 living creatures, and in the midst of the elders, stood a lamb, as though it had been slain, having 7 horns and 7 eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. Then he came and took the scroll out of the right hand of him who sat on the throne. Now when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each having a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, "You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain and have redeemed us to God by your blood out of every tribe and tongue and people and nation, and have made us kings and priests to our God, and we shall reign on the earth." Then I looked, and I heard the voice of many angels around the throne, the living creatures, the elders, and the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000, thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing." And every creature which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth, and such as are in the sea and all that are in them, I heard saying, "Blessing and honor and glory and power be to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb forever and ever." Then the four living creatures said, "Amen." And the 24 elders fell down and worshiped him who lives forever and ever and ever and ever and forever. Whew. Father God, would you take these words of yours and by your Spirit apply them to our lives? You know those who are here and those who are watching that are really struggling with life and the stuff that's going on in their life. You know those who've never really surrendered their life to you. So I'm asking you, reveal yourself by your word, through your Spirit. And I pray that lives would be different because of these minutes that you talk to us. You talk to us. You talk to us now, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. As you're seated, just leave the Bible open to that. Let's just unpack these verses. We won't get through all of them. I've been preaching for, this is my 51st year, and I don't remember any sermon I've ever finished. I quit, but I just never was finished. But let's just walk through these, starting with verse 1. When he talks about this scroll, to me, this is one of the most exciting chapters in all the Bible about this book that answers that question, who is worthy? Here's the question, who is worthy to take this book and to open its seals? That the word worthy means who has earned the right? Who is capable because of the right they've earned to control human destiny? Boy, that's the key question. That's what verse 1 is all about, this scroll. And then the angels ask that question in verse 2, who is worthy? That's what I've been dealing with. All of us in life have things come into our life we never planned, we never anticipated. I had no idea. I thought I would get old in life, and when I finally left this, the last church where I was pastoring, I would go somewhere, retire, fish the rest of my life. I had no idea. God had another assignment for it. And then here I am, 8 months, 2 weeks, 3 days later. I said, "God, what are you doing? What's happening in my life?" Have you ever been to that place where things have just not turned out the way they were? I can tell by looking at some of you, say, "Well, Michael, first of all, I didn't even know there was a book like that. And I've certainly not asked the question, who is worthy to open this book and to break its seals?" Well, you may not have said it in those words. But by controlling human destiny, I mean, who is able to prevent all those things from happening that should not happen and cause to accomplish everything that needs to be accomplished. Who is capable? I mean, am I capable? The angel asked the question in verse 2, who is worthy? Look at that. To open the scroll and to loose its seal. Who's worthy? Who's capable? Who's earned the right to control their own life? Am I capable? Can I do that? Or is my life just run by blind faith? It's just que sera, or, oh, that was, we use the word luck, which there's no such thing. Luck is from the Roman god Lucan, which is paganism. Is it luck? Is it bad luck? Is it coincidence? Is it, oh, hey, is it the stars? Do I need to find my sign and look at the horoscope? And is it the stars that determine my destiny, what happens in my life? Is it the government? I know, that's even funny to think about. Are they controlling my life? Who's in charge? Who's control? Who's capable? Who's earned the right to take this brook? That's the key question. All humanity's been dealing with that question. Am I capable? If I go to the right school, if I meet the right people, if I have the right major, if I take the right classes, if I have the right job, move in the right area, marry the right person, of course, am I able through my own ability, if I eat the right things and don't eat the wrong things and exercise the right way and take the right class, am I able to cause my life to turn out the way I want it to? Am I capable of doing that? Am I worthy to take, no, I don't care about ruling your life. Can I even control my own destiny? And the answer is no. No one can. But that's the question that's haunted humanity. It started all the way back. Hey, go before the Garden of Eden. Go up to heaven. Look at that beautiful angel. When he spoke, it was like a symphony. Ezekiel chapter 28, Isaiah chapter 14 describes this being Lucifer, son of the morning. And his first mistake was looking at himself. If you notice, every sentence begins with I. I am too beautiful. I am too wise to be anything less than God. I will exalt myself above the throne of God. I will ascend into I. His problem was, of course, he had eye problems. His whole life centered around I. I do not want anybody else to control the events. I will determine my own destiny. And that's what called him to be Satan. It was all about I. And so when he came to planet Earth and there were these two humans, happily married couple, Adam and Eve, he infected them with that same ideal. Hey, you don't have to do what God said to do. Well, you won't surely die. Control your own destiny. Be your own boss. Call your own shots. Determine what happens to your own life. It was nothing more than a blatant attempt. You control your own destiny. You take the book of your life. And all of us who have come from Adam and Eve have inherited that same attitude. I'll do what I want to do when I want to do when I want to do it. I. That's why the middle letter in sin is S-I. And it all revolves around I, an I attitude. And the history of humanity is who is able to take this book, the book of destiny, and control our own lives. Every false religion, every cult, every ism and schism has all been come to pass to answer that question. Can I, if I keep the five pillars of Islam, if I live this way in Buddhism, Hinduism, if I do certain things, it's always around do, can I control my own destiny? The lamas, would you go to the Himalayas that I've been to, climb the Himalayas and go up to those Buddhist monasteries, the lamas are in there, and they'll seal themselves up for 30 years and spend hours at a time unlocking their minds They believe that if you unlock your mind, your thought life, just let all the thoughts go out and see what good thoughts come in. Release your mind. Release your mind. Don't control it. I shouldn't use the word stupid. How unwise that is. I mean, I live 2 miles from here, and since we've moved here, I can't imagine Tiber telling me, Michael, let's just open up all of our windows and open up our doors and go to bed and see what good comes in tonight. I mean, if we wouldn't do it to our house, why do it to our mind? Pastor Kenny's leading us through that teaching right now. But the Buddhists thought that if we spend 30 years and through transcendental meditation, we can become one with the universe and realize I really am God. I can control my own destiny. Nirvana. Of course, it never happens. Why fall for that stuff? Now, in America, see, that seems so far removed from those of us in Wilmington, North Carolina. But those of us who are the hippie age and older can remember Dr. Leary. Timothy Leary was in Harvard, and he was the influence on the East Coast like the other professors were in Haight-Ashbury on the West Coast. And being Americans, they didn't have 30 years to do this, so they experimented with a drug called LSD, which was nothing more than a fast shortcut to becoming one with the universe, to expanding our mind, to realize that I'm God and I can control my own life. They can't even control their hairdo. Nothing but an old attempt to wrest from the hand of God the book and say, I'll control my own destiny. And so the angel asks the question, who is worthy to open the scroll and to loose its seals? Verse 3, and no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll. No one was. I looked everywhere on heaven and on earth. I looked, hey, there's Abraham, the father of the faith. Abraham, are you able to? He says, I can't even control my own destiny. I can't even keep up with which wife I have. Well, hey, Moses, what about Moses? Surely you're worthy. Moses can't control his destiny. Hey, the apple of God's eye, the king of Israel, the forerunner of our Lord Jesus. David, are you capable? Are you worthy? David, oh, he's not worthy. Hey, what about the disciples? They lived and ate and taught with the Lord Jesus. Are any of you worthy? James, John, Peter couldn't control his own tongue. He wasn't able to control his destiny. What about this? I looked on earth, he says in verse, there's no one on earth. There's no one under the earth. Not the Apostle Paul. Not even Paul is capable of controlling those. There's no one worthy. And he said in verse 4, so I wept much. John's tears were symbolic of every person who looks at their life and say, whew, things sure didn't turn out the way I thought they were. Just parentheses for a minute. If I were to come to you, those of you, say 30 years old and older, and ask you this personal question, hey, has your life turned out the way you thought it was going to? All of those, I think one of the chief causes of clinical depression and discouragement and disappointment is we look back at our dreams. You remember in high school and college and thinking it was going to be that I'm going to die, then we're going to die, and then I'm going to die. And then you look at your life and say, well, man, none of that has happened. I mean, I am alive. That's about the only thing that's still true. No one was worthy, and I wept, he says, because no one was found worthy to open and read the scroll or to look at it. Verse 5, but one of the elders said to me, do not weep. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has prevailed to open the scroll and to loose its seal. There is no human being who's ever lived, who's ever been able to control his destiny, who's been able to prevent those things from happening that shouldn't happen and to accomplish everything that ought to be accomplished. There's never been, except one. Don't weep, John. There is one. He's the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He's the root of David. And he has prevailed. He is the only one capable. I'm telling you, I find peace in my heart when I realize my life is in the hands of somebody who's absolutely worthy of controlling the events of my life. He is worthy, he said. And he says in verse 7, or verse 6, I looked, and behold, in the midst of the throne and of the four living creatures, and in the midst of the elders, stood a lamb. Wait a minute. You got his attention when you said, there is one. He's the Lion of the tribe of Judah. And when I looked, I didn't see a lion. I saw a lamb. Well, which one is he? Is he a lion or a lamb? And the answer is yes. I saw a lamb as though it had been slain, having seven horns. Having seven horns. Seven is the number of perfection, remember? This book is sealed with seven seals. Seven, it means perfection, completion. This book is absolutely complete. It's completely full. Nothing can be added to it. Nothing can be taken away from it. Nothing can slip out. It is perfectly sealed, is perfectly secret. Seven seals. And the one who takes it has seven horns. Horns represents authority, power. Here's a person who has seven absolute power. There's nothing impossible for him. He has seven horns, and verse 6 says he has seven eyes. He's not only able to do anything, he's able to know everything. He sees everything. He knows everything. I don't even know what I'm having for lunch today. He knows everything about everybody for all times. Here's the point. You and I will never find fulfillment or purpose or meaning, much less joy or happiness, unless we're willing to take our place along the thousands and thousands times tens of thousands who say, worthy is the Lamb to take my book and to break the seals. Not just at one point in your life, but day after day when you're in that emergency room, when the doctor comes out and gets you and the family and says, let's go in this private room. When you're waiting there for the highway patrolman to speak to you. When you're in the funeral home. When you're in the darkest time of your life, to constantly make that confession, Lord Jesus Christ, you are worthy to take the scroll of my life and to break the seals. You are worthy of controlling my life. Here's my body. God the Father doesn't need a body. God the Son already has a body. God the Holy Spirit, here's my body. Whatever you want to do with it. If you want to send it to the other part of the world, it's your body. If you want to wreck this body with pain and cancer and incurable, Lord, it's your body. I'm not going to whine and complain and moan everything that comes in. Lord Jesus, you have the right to do with me as you please. Have you come to that place? He is worthy to control the events of our life. You know why? Let me give you three reasons and we'll leave. We're through. We're over halfway through. I'm saying that not for my privilege. I know why I am. You need to know that. Jesus Christ is completely capable of controlling our life. First of all, because of the death that he bore. He's worthy of controlling my life because of the death that he bore. That's what he talks about over and over and over. Yeah, I looked and behold, I saw a lamb as though it had been slain. A lamb that had been slain. One thing God will never have you and I forget, and that is the death of Jesus Christ. That's the gospel. Christ died for our sins and was buried and rose again the third day according to that's the gospel. God knew that all of us were following the same pattern from our nature. We got the old Adam nature inside of us that it's all about me. I'll do what I want to do when I want to do it. And I'm going to try to control my own destiny. I'll go to church when I have to, if that's what it takes to get to heaven. I'll be as religious as I need to, but I'm going to call the shots in my life. That's the old attitude all of us have. From little children on, we were born that way. And that separates us from a holy, righteous God. And God would be perfectly just to leave us in that lost, separated condition, but He loves us. I can't explain that. He just loves us. And so God said, you can never bridge the gap between you and me. You can never make up for your sin. You can never pay for it. I'll do for you what you can't do for yourself. And so God became a human and lived a human life, except He never sinned. He never did anything, said anything, thought anything wrong. And then in the prime of His life, He laid down His life. He's the only one who is capable of controlling the events of His life. He accomplished everything that should be accomplished, and He prevented everything that needed to be prevented. What about the cross? Yeah, even that. They didn't take Jesus' life. They didn't kill Jesus. They didn't murder Jesus. Jesus said, no man takes my life from me. I willingly lay it down. And if I'm able to lay it down, I'm able to pick it up again. All through His arrest, His torture, His crucifixion, He was completely in charge the whole time. He's worthy. He's worthy because of the death that He bore. And God doesn't want us to ever forget what Jesus Christ did for us. Don't ever forget that. It's by the blood. Without the shedding of blood, that scarlet thread of redemption is all the way through this book from Genesis through the end of the, here we are in Revelation. And in Revelation, when we see our King, He's the Lamb that's been slain. Don't ever be, you'll never grow beyond the blood of Jesus Christ. I don't care how mature you get in your faith, you will never become more mature that you're no longer want to talk about the blood or be associated with the blood. It is by the blood. What can wash away our sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. I know where some people get too sophisticated for that. I don't know this gory stuff. The Bible says the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness. But to those of us who are being saved, it's the power of God. Jesus Christ is worthy to control what goes on in my life because of the death that He bore. It was, first of all, a violent death. It wasn't a quick death. It wasn't a simple death. It was a violent death. I mean, there's a phrase that's used three times in chapter 5. In verse 6, it says, I saw a lamb as though it had been slain. See the word slain? Verse 9, for you were slain. Verse 12, worthy is the lamb who was slain. Slain, slain, slain. That word slain means slaughtered. It literally means to slit the throat. Wait a minute, Jesus wasn't beheaded. That death is over with like that. He didn't have a sword running through His heart. Been over with like that. This was a violent, excruciating death. Even the death of the cross. God has highly exalted Him because of His death on the cross. Do you understand how violent that was? Modern pictures. I love them. I don't love it, but of all the pictures about the crucifixion of Jesus, Mel Gibson's picture, The Passion, captures it more than any that I've seen. And even that, no Hollywood picture, beloved, can ever give justice to how violent His death really was. This word slain is the same word. It's the priest taking the head of the innocent lamb, jerking it taut and then slitting it with a razor sharp knife and blood pouring everywhere. It's to be slaughtered as a sacrifice. It's taking the body of Jesus Christ and having two Roman soldiers whose whole occupation was scourging. They take this scourge with pieces of iron or pieces of bone at the end of it. And one would start at the neck and work his way down. The other would start at the ankles and work his way up. And with a cadence count, they would throw that into the flesh. And when it stuck in, they would pull at the same time. Layer, they knew exactly how many layers to take off lest the person be literally disemboweled. And they always left just one last layer. That's our Lord Jesus. They plucked his beard. You don't do that one hair at a time. You do that huge sections of your face. They nailed his crown of his head with thorns. Isaiah chapter 52 says when his visage was marred more than any man. That's the language that says when you looked at this piece of meat on the cross, is that a human? Is that a goat? What is that? Violent. Why was his death so violent? Because of the reason he died. He died to pay for our sins. Listen to me. Will y'all stay with me? There's three ways you can look at sin. A physician could look at sin like a disease. And even though God is the great physician, he does not look on our sin like a disease. If you were a teacher, an educator, you could look at sin like ignorance. And even though our God is the master teacher, he does not see our sin as mere ignorance. He is seated on a throne. Therefore, our God is a judge, a righteous judge. And being a judge, he sees our sin not as a disease or as ignorant, but as rebellion, as lawlessness. And therefore, as a judge, he has to condemn that person to the most horrifying death imaginable, even the death of the cross. Oh, Lord Jesus. He's worthy of controlling my life because of the death that he bore. He not only bore a violent death, but secondly, it was a vicarious death. He did it for me. God has made him who knew no sin to become sin for us. For us. That word for means in place of us. That we being dead to sin should live unto righteousness. So he died for us. That's what a lamb that was slain. This lamb hadn't done anything wrong. The lamb was a sacrifice in substitute for someone else. That's Jesus. His death was a violent death. His death was a vicarious death. And his death was a victorious death. That's why in verse 5, that word just jumps out at me. In verse 5, he says, behold, the lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, has prevailed. That word prevail means overcome. He's overcome. That word overcome is used 21 times in the New Testament. That's the word of victory. And that's why verse 6, when he sees the lamb, verse 6 says, there stood a lamb as though it had been slain. If this lamb had been slain, I thought it would be laying down. But here's a lamb that had been slaughtered and now is standing. This same Jesus Christ who died such a violent death on my behalf, 3 days later walked out of the grave. Ruling victorious. There's the position of victorious. That's why he deserves the right to control the destiny of our lives, because of the death that he bore. Secondly, he deserves to control our lives, not just because of the death that he bore, but because of the deliverance he bought. That's why Revelation chapter 5, verse 9 says, they sang a new song saying, you are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain and have redeemed us to God by your blood. You have redeemed us to God by your blood out of every tribe and tongue and people and nation. He's saying that this Jesus Christ who died didn't die for white Americans. He died for the whole world. Jesus said, you've asked me, when will the end be? Matthew 24, verse 15. And the good news shall be preached unto all nations. That word nations is ethne, people groups. There's over 12,000 people groups on earth. When every people group has heard the gospel, then the end will come. And he says, Jesus, you deserve to take the book and to open the seals because You were slain and you've redeemed us to God. You know the word redeem means to buy back and set free. You have bought me back. You've bought me with a price and set me free. You've redeemed. See, the word redemption is used two ways in Scripture. I'm trying to hurry. We are redeemed from sin. And secondly, we're redeemed unto God. Revelation talks about the second aspect. We have been delivered from sin, but that's not the end of the story. Thank God. We don't go to hell when we die. We go to heaven. We spend eternity. That's a byproduct. But here's the real deal. We've been redeemed unto God. We become His purchased possession. The main beneficiary of the death of Jesus Christ was not the sinner, but the Savior. The one who benefits most of the cross of Jesus Christ is not, I get to go. And I'm not belittling that. Thank God I live forever. And so does everyone who gives their life to Jesus. But the main benefit is what God receives. You know what He receives? You. And you, and you, and you. You are His valued possession. He didn't save you because you're valuable. You're valuable because He saved you. You're not getting it. The value of something is determined by two things: the price that was paid for it and to whom it belongs. Paul prayed for the Ephesian church that they would understand the riches of his inheritance in the saints. The riches of his inheritance in the saints. What are his riches? Is it the cattle on 1,000 hills? Well, the price of beef these days, that's very valuable, but that doesn't make him rich. What about gold, bringing him all the gold and silver? That won't make him rich. Casting our crowns at his feet, that'd make him rich. No, nowhere in the Bible are crowns referred to as riches. You know what his riches are? It's you. It's you. Everything he did so he could have you. That's how valuable you are to him. The riches of his glory in the saints. Tiber and I used to live in Memphis, Tennessee, and not far from where Elvis. Elvis was alive at the time. He's not alive now. And if you go to his house now, there's a case, of course, all of his memorabilia is there, and you pay a good price to get to see that. But there's an enclosed case with his comb. It's sealed and has security cameras around it. And I've not had one recently, but I've had combs before. But they've never had security. What makes that so? The value of something is determined by the price that was paid for it and whom it belongs to. You're the most valuable possession in all the universes, all the solar systems, because you were bought with the precious royal blood of Jesus Christ, and you belong to Him. Woo! Let me just shout myself. That's how important you are. Jesus, you're worthy because, number one, the death you bore. Secondly, because of the deliverance He bought. And last of all, because of the dominion He bestows. The Bible says in verse 10, He has made us kings and priests to God, and we shall reign on earth. That's the dominion. Kings and priests. Kings speak of authority. Jesus said, all authority has been given to me in heaven and earth. You go, therefore, and make disciples. I'm giving you my authority. As the Father hath sent me, John 20:21, I'm sending you. You've got that authority. He's made us kings and priests. Priest speaks of access. You and I, through Jesus Christ, have immediate access. Here's what I have to do to talk to God. Just talk to Him. In fact, I can talk to Him without even saying it verbally. I have immediate access with God, and I can take anybody with me, whether they want to go or not. It's access. He has bestowed that dominion upon us. Wow. What a Jesus. Have you surrendered everything to Him? Those of you that are his followers, has there been times recently when you say, like you wish you had every day, Lord Jesus, I don't understand this. This throws me for a loop. It's not in my calendar. This is certainly not in my checkbook, but you know what? You've got the book of my life. And whatever happens, I know you're in control. Have you done that recently? There's some of you listening to me that have never done that for the first time in your life. You're still trying to call the shots. No wonder you're frustrated. No wonder you're not living a life of joy that he wants you to have. I'm going to ask you today to turn that control over to him and say, Jesus Christ, you're the only one who's worthy, and I'm giving you my book. Would you stand to your feet and bow your heads where you are? Here's your opportunity right now to do this. Maybe you're watching online or you're here in this room and you've never surrendered all, but you're willing to right now. Then tell him that. Lord Jesus, I'm giving you all of my life. I've been in control. I've been calling the shots. But I'm giving you all my life for the rest of my life. Save me. Live inside of me. If that's your commitment today, dear sir, ma'am, dear young person, if today you're surrendering your life to him, share that with somebody. Jesus said, whoever confesses me before men, him will I confess before my Father. But whoever denies me before men, him will I deny before my Father. There's going to be staff and counselors here at the front. When we're dismissed in just a few moments, would you come and talk to one of them and say, I want to share with you, I want to give all my life to Jesus starting today. Or maybe you're here and say, I've been saved, but I've not followed in baptism. I want to do that. And maybe you're a brother and sister that's here and say, I want to make a commitment that every day of my life, this will be my thought. Jesus, you're worthy to take my scroll. That's what I pray too, Father. May this be the fresh thought in everyone's mind, because you're worthy. That's what I pray in Jesus' name. Brother Mike, you come and lead us.
Thank you, Brother Mike. Well, thank you so much for being here today. If you're a guest with us, we all encourage you to fill out a Connect card, whether online or at Guest Central. Few things to remind you of. Hey, men, this coming Saturday, our men's fellowship breakfast is taking place 8 o'clock. You can sign up online or you can sign up at Guest Central. Also, we're having a marriage event this Friday night with Pastor Kenny. If you'd like to be part of that, you can sign up online or at Guest Central as well. And then, ladies, I ask you to mark your calendars for February the 25th. It's a Friday evening. You are having an event in here, and you can get more information about that out at our women's ministry table. But it is a joy to have you here. But as Mike just said, I hope you understand how valuable you are, how much God loved you and sent his son to die for you. That's how valuable you are to him. And if you've never trusted him, we'll have men and women here to help you with that greatest decision of your life. Maybe you're here and you are saved, but you're having struggles. We have people here to pray for you. Man, we want you to experience life, and not just salvation, but man, I'm talking about real life, the power that comes through a relationship with our God through Jesus Christ. And so I pray you will take advantage of that, because it's the greatest decision you can make. Would you pray with me? Father, we're thankful for this day. Thank you for the Word of God that leads us into all truth. Thank you for the message that we've heard today. How worthy is the Lord Jesus? How much our Father valued our lives to send his Son, Jesus to pay the price for our sins. But Father, not to leave us there, but Father, to empower us to be able to walk in life as witnesses, to share the testimony and the hope. And so, Father, I pray today that we would surrender all that we are to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And thank you. Thank you for this opportunity, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. We're here if you need us.